There we have it. We built an actual API which returns SpaceX data. And I think that's cool. Having a public API like SpaceX data is perfect for testing stuff. If you want to learn how to do GraphQL, hopefully you will by the end of this video. GraphQL is an open source query language for APIs and a runtime for executing those queries against your current data. It provides a more efficient and optimized way of requesting data compared to traditional REST APIs. GraphQL works by allowing the clients to specify which data they want back from the server. Now, of course, you need to specify these in your type definitions, but basically this eliminates underfetching and overfetching of the data that the client needs. Clients send queries of the data they need and get a response with a JSON format of the data they actually requested. Nothing more, nothing less. This allows for more efficient retrieval of data and not making round trip requests to the API. One of the use cases for a GraphQL server is to use it as an aggregate layer in front of multiple REST APIs. This allows for the client to not worry about the different APIs you have on the far end, just to interact with the GraphQL layer, and the GraphQL layer handles all the requests and grabs the data from the different microservice REST APIs. And GraphQL has a lot of other advantages as well. It's a very powerful tool that I believe is very useful to learn and to know how to use. A simple way to explain how GraphQL works is when a request comes in, the GraphQL server looks at the data that was requested, finds the resolver for that query or mutation, and resolves the data back to the client. Okay, so now let's go in VS Code and actually build a GraphQL server using TypeScript and the SpaceX public API. Now I have a simple package here set up. This is a package JSON. It has a few dependencies, the Apollo server, GraphQL, and sometimes in TypeScript. And I'm using ESBuild to build this project and run it. You can use whatever you want. This is just my choice. There's a few steps you need to actually have a GraphQL server. So I'm gonna go in the index file. This is the entry point for my application. And here you can see I'm creating a new Apollo server with type definitions and resolvers. And then I'm starting the standalone server and then listening to a port 400 so I can actually make requests and see what's happening. Introspection, by the way, means that if you use tools like Postman or Insomnia, they can grab the introspection and see all the type definitions, which is one of the cool things about GraphQL. It's kind of like documentation without actually needing to write documentation. But anyways, let's get into it, shall we? If you go to the type definitions, we can define the types and the queries we want our server to have. So let's go ahead and define a query called launchpads. And this will return an array of launchpad. Now this is a type that I haven't defined yet, but we'll define in a minute. This is how you can define a return of an array. The exclamation points here means that this field is required. So the response for this query is required to have an array and is required to have at least one launchpad. Now let's define our launchpad type. GitHub Copilot is very useful here. It already knows some of the stuff. There's a lot of information that the public API gives us, but I'm not going to use all of that. I'm just going to find a few that we can test with. I've just saved this and this will our type definitions for now. Now let's actually add a resolver that will be called whenever we make a request with this query, we want to resolve some kind of details so the client has all the information that it needs, right? So I have a file here, which is basically exporting an object of resolvers. This is similar to the schema, so we need to define a resolver for this launchpad query. So here we can say, so all of the parameters here have their own function. Parent means that this, if the resolver is chained, which I have another video coming for that, but just know that there's a parent, which the resolver is chained, this will be the value of the parent resolver. Arguments are all the arguments you send in the request. For example, if I have another request, which I'll define later, but if I have a request to get only one launchpad, and it's going to return one launch pad. We can also define the parameters we want to send. So I'll say I want launch pad with a certain ID. So this is basically like a function which you make a request to, and you send variables like the ID, and it's going to give you a launch pad with that ID. And then the ID will be in the arguments parameter here. Context, this is an Apollo server context, and it's you can save data here and use it in other places. I have another video coming for this as well, so for now just know that it's something that you can store data into and use it for all the resolvers. And the info is because with GraphQL you can only ask for certain fields of the object, this contains which fields are actually requested. It's a bit weird to get the data from here. There's actually packages to help you with that, but I'm not gonna bother with that for now. Now in this resolver, I'm just gonna make a request to the SpaceX data API to get the launch pads. And I'm gonna use fetch for that, and that's basically it. I'm just gonna use the version 4, and I only want the JSON response in this. I don't really want the response back. Now let's try this. Go, our service is running. Now I'm gonna make a new request. Now, all requests to GraphQL server are post requests. So let's go ahead and make a request. It's gonna be localhost 400. I'm gonna use a GraphQL body, which is basically JSON with query and GraphQL variables. Then we have launch pads. This is the introspection I mentioned. Because Postman has fetched the schema, it already knows that these are the two available queries that I can use. Now let's use, let's define the fields we want for the object. I'm just gonna use some of them, name, description. Latitude, longitude, perfect. Let's make a request and see. There we go. And this here, we can see returns back the launch pads, an array of launch pads with the details we requested. Now we can make a request to not include some of the fields, for example. And we see that the server responds with only the fields that we requested with. Now I'm gonna show you how you can use the ID variable here. Let's define a resolver for launch pad. And there we go. Copilot already knows what I want. So we're gonna have the arguments. We'll already have the ID that we sent from the request, and we're gonna make a request to this SpaceX data API with the ID from the request, and we're gonna return the JSON back. Let's restart our server and let's test this. I'm gonna grab the first ID here, and I'm gonna make a new request, HTTP localhost 4000, and it's gonna be a query to get launch. Actually, it's gonna be launch pad, and now I can pass an ID. Before in the query, we're gonna define an ID variable, which is gonna be of type ID, and we're gonna pass that variable to the query like this. And we're gonna ask for some details here. And now in the variables, this is basically a JSON object. We're gonna pass the ID, which is the one I copied from the other response. And there we go. Now this now returns only one launch pad with the same ID that I sent in here. Perfect. Now that we have this, one of the best things to use GraphQL for is if you want it to be like a layer between the clients and multiple REST APIs. So I'm going to define a new type here called city. And what this is going to be for is basically we're going to make another request to GeoDataSource API, and we're going to grab the city for the latitude and longitude of the launch pad. This is how you build upon your API if you want to use multiple REST APIs to get data from. And let's create a new query here called city, in which we're going to send a lat, which is going to be a float, and the longitude float, and this is going to return the city. So this is a new query we're defining now. Now we need to define the resolver for that query. It's not the API I want to use. And yeah, that's basically it. So this is another API we're making a request to. We're passing an API key, which is basically a free tier API key. We're passing the latitude and longitude from our request to get the city with those details, and basically returning the JSON response back to the client. Perfect. Now let's restart our server and go back. I'm gonna copy these two so we can get the city for these details. Make another request. It's going to be again a post request, HTTP localhost. Here we go. It says this. Perfect. Now, this is apparently in a city called Surf in the US in California, and the sunrise was at 7 a.m. and the sunset was at 5 p.m. And you can see the power here with GraphQL. You don't have to make multiple requests to multiple REST APIs to get this. So now the client will only need to know one URL and just make different calls to grab the details from that API. And doesn't have to care about the smaller details like API keys and other stuff. Now, one of the caveats to mention when working with GraphQL is if the schema is valid, the request is always going to be with status 200. Now, even if there are some errors from the resolvers, this will still return 200, which might be confusing compared to REST APIs. The reason why GraphQL returns 200 status because you can request multiple data in the request, and maybe some of the chain resolvers errored out, but GraphQL will still return the data that was successfully retrieved and resolved. It will also show you some of the errors found in the REST. So it basically returns partial data and the errors instead of just erroring and not returning any of the data. Now, this could be advantage or a disadvantage. It's just the way you're using it. But I thought it's good to mention. Some of the pros when using GraphQL is you can provide which data you need. So this really helps when the client actually doesn't need the full object of anything. It needs some of the fields, and you can define in the request which fields you want the server to return. It can also be used for type safety. So whenever you're making a request using Postman can fetch the type definitions of your server and actually give you, while you're typing the request, it will give you an autofill and whenever you make errors in the types. So this allows for type safe requests, and GraphQL auto documents your code as you go along. Now, I didn't really find this to be exactly true, but the good thing is because you have the type definitions, all the resolvers, you can actually see what each of the queries and mutations are supposed to return and what it's supposed to do. And because of the introspection that GraphQL has, you can look at those types from Postman or any other request tool and actually see what all the queries are, what do they return. And this basically serves like a small documentation for someone that's just starting to use your server. Now, some of the cons for GraphQL is it can have a learning curve. When I first started, I needed a minute to realize what's going on, how is it different than REST APIs, and how I can actually use it to its potential. The other thing is it's not very good for file uploads. Basically, all the requests made to GraphQL server are going to be a JSON body, so you can't really send a file unless you send blobs of the file in a JSON format. With a REST API, when you make a GET request, your browser will actually cache that, which can be good, but because all of the GraphQL requests, even if you're getting stuff, are POST, that means that there's not going to be any HTTP caching. Like anything nowadays, GraphQL has alternatives. Some of them, most notable one that I can find, is RESTQL, which is query language for microservices, which allows you to query your microservices basically in a very similar way as GraphQL. And the other one I found is called Falcor, which is built by Netflix, and this powers the query language on Netflix UI. I haven't really used any of these. It's worth noting there's alternatives out there for anything nowadays. And that's pretty much all for this video. I hope you liked it. I hope you learned something. There's a lot of nuances and cool things you can do with GraphQL, and I'm just scratching the surface here. Yeah, if you have any feedback, any comments, any thoughts, let them know down in the comment section, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.